Hello and welcome to Controllers Tech. This is the fourth video in the ADC series of the STM32. In the previous video we saw how to read the multiple channels of the ADC using the DMA. We used the DMA in normal mode, therefore the DMA transferred the data only once, and then stopped. In order to fetch the conversion data from the ADC, we needed to start the ADC again in the DMA mode. Today we will keep reading the multiple channels using the DMA, but we will do it in the circular mode. This way we would need to start the ADC in DMA mode just once, and the DMA will continue fetching the data from the ADC. I will continue where we left the previous project. Let's open the CubeMX to modify the previous project. Here the four channels are already selected, and the scan conversion mode is also enabled. Let's go to the DMA section, and select the circular mode for the DMA. In circular mode, the DMA will continue to transfer the data from the ADC. Now in the conversion data management mode, select the circular DMA. We also want the ADC channel's data to get updated, so enable the continuous conversion mode. This will allow the ADC to start another set of conversions as soon as the first set is finished. This way the DMA will always have the updated data to transfer from the ADC. Rest of the configuration will remain the same as we did in the previous video. Let's generate the code for our new project. Before we proceed ahead, let's see the configuration needed for the other MCUs as well. Here is the image showing the configuration for F446RE. We need to enable the continuous conversion mode, and also the DMA continuous request. Also in the DMA section, make sure that the DMA is configured in the circular mode. The rest of the configuration is the same as what we used in the normal DMA mode. Here is another image showing the configuration for F103C8. We just need to enable the continuous conversion mode, as we do not have the options for others. Now in the DMA section, make sure that the DMA is configured in the circular mode. The rest of the configuration remains the same as we used in the normal DMA mode. Alright, let's build the project once. Since we are using the DMA in the circular mode, we do not need to call it again and again. We will call it only once in the main function, and it will keep fetching the data automatically. You can use the conversion complete callback to process the ADC data. Let's debug the project to see the working. The ADC value array is already added to the live expression, so let's run the debugger. You can see all the values of the array are varying very fast. This means that the DMA is able to fetch the updated data on each call. I am varying the potentiometer 3, and you can see the variations in the third element of the array. Now I am varying the potentiometer 2, and you can see the changes in the second element of the array. Similarly, other ADC values are also varying as per the potentiometers. The count variable is updating every 500 milliseconds, that means the while loop is executing at the normal rate as well. So we are able to read the multiple ADC channels using the circular DMA mode, where we just start the ADC once, and the DMA continuously fetches the updated results from each channel. Now since we are using the DMA in a Cortex-M7 based MCU, let's also discuss the issue of cache coherency. As per ST's recommendation, we should use the cache in a Cortex-M7 based MCU. This improves the overall system performance. So let's enable the instruction and data cache in the configuration here. When we use the cache along with the DMA, we face the issue of cache coherency, where the DMA reads the cached data instead of the actual data. To avoid this issue, we can configure the memory protection unit of the MCU, and set the data region non-cacheable. So let's enable the MPU in the default mode. I am going to relocate the ADC value array in the RAM D2, whose base address is 30 million hex. The ADC value array is 16 bits in size, and we have a total of 4 elements in it. Therefore the array size is 8 bytes in total. Although here we have 32 bytes as the least possible size, so let's select it. Now permit all the access, and disable all the access permissions. I have already explained in detail about the MPU configuration in 5 video series, you can check them out to understand the memory protection unit. Alright, now the first thing we need to do is, relocate the ADC value array to another memory location. We can use the section attribute to do so. Here I am relocating it to the section ADC array. Now we need to define this location in the flash script. As I mentioned earlier, I want to relocate the buffer to the RAM D2, which actually starts at the address 30 million hex. Therefore we will link the section ADC array here. The rest of the code remains the same. We are starting the ADC in DMA mode just once, and then the DMA will keep transferring the updated data from the ADC channels. Let's build and debug the project. You can see the ADC value array is updating as it should. This means the DMA is able to fetch the updated data, instead of the cached one. So we are able to read the multiple channels of the ADC using the DMA. We started the ADC in the DMA mode just once, and then the DMA was continuously fetching the data from the ADC. The DMA was even able to fetch the updated data, so there was no issue of cache coherency while using the Cortex-M7 based MCU. We will continue the series, and in the next video we will see how to read multiple channels without the DMA. This is it for the video. I hope everything was clear. You can download the project from the link in the description. Leave comments in case of any doubt. Keep watching, and have a nice day ahead.